Good morning, good morning, good morning. I feel so much better, y'all. I feel so much better. You guys begin to come into the room. Just want to give me some water. And we're going to go ahead and get started in just about a good 2-3 minutes. Let you guys come on in the room. Good morning. Good morning. Good morning, good morning. You guys begin to come on in the room. All right, good morning. Good morning, how y'all doing this morning? I guess we'll go and get started while we still got a little bit of time. This is Faith for Financial Freedom. This is George Howard. Well, we believe and teach one thing, that is that poverty is a mindset. If you can change your mind about money, money will change its mind about you. Broke is a temporary condition. Y'all need to get that into your spirit. Get into your spirit now. Get into your spirit now. Get into your spirit now. Money management is a mindset. If you can change your mind about money, money will change its mind about you. Poverty is a mindset, y'all. Broke is a temporary condition. So if you broke, somebody just say it's just temporary. Won't be here always. As I change my mind, well, my money is going to begin to change. So we're here every single day from 7 a.m. Doing meditationals. And then on next week, we'll resume back at 7:30 p.m. doing the life application part. And that is, you know, faith without works is dead. We teach the faith in the morning, the works in the afternoon. Watch them come together and watch God bless the works of your hands. I'm so excited about it. We've been talking about for weeks now, I actually started off with taming of the tongue. We went from confession. We went from confession to the taming of the tongue. And now we're talking about our heart condition. How the enemy would actually come in and try to put doubt in your heart. And there's so many things that will be in our heart. And because they're in our heart, we actually want to make sure that we rectify that with the word of God. I don't know why I got mixed up this morning. Listen, I feel so much better, y'all. Y'all don't understand. I got some sleep last night. I mean, some actual sleep. I really rested. I feel revived. I feel renewed. I feel restored. I feel refreshed. I feel good in Jesus' name. I'm so happy and so ecstatic, man. I felt like I was dragging. Like, oh. So I'm excited. So let's get in this word. Let's dig in here and let's pull out some nuggets and let's do a good job. Okay. All right. So we think we stopped at Joshua 1:7-8 yesterday. Joshua 1:7-8. He was talking about being in good success and how you're supposed to meditate on the law of God. When we say meditate on the law of God, that is meditate. I believe that meditation is meditate. You know, when we usually talk about meditation, it's usually some spooky, some eerie thing that somebody does. It's usually like yoga or some kind of meditational candlelight ceremony or something. That's one form of meditation. But meditation is, we do it every single day. You meditate every single day. And that is simply, what are you feeding yourself through your eyes and through your ears? That's what you are focusing on. That is the concentration of your heart. That's what you're feeding yourself. You're feeding yourself something. Meditation simply means this. Me did eight. Meditate. Me did eight. What are you actually consuming? What are you consuming? What are you consuming? Are you consuming the word of God or are you consuming the world? And I know this sounds so cliche-ish. But I'm so sincere when I say this. I know it sounds cliche-ish, but I'm so sincere when I say this. We have to focus on what are we putting in our body. Listen, I know you're like, okay, I thought we were talking about money. I thought we were talking about money management and all that. We are. I guarantee you, we are. The reason we cannot see the blessings of God upon our life is because nobody ever talks about the conditions that are tied to the blessings. There are conditions that are tied to the blessing of God. God says, okay, I saved you. You're saved. But to walk in the blessing, there are some requirements that I would like for you to do. One would be, I want you to get in the word. I mean, as you begin to grow in me, I begin to give you more because I know you can be trusted more, because the more you get into this word, the more you become like me. And the more you become like me, the more I can trust you with things that I can't trust other people with in the kingdom. And so we want to make sure that we're doing what's right to keep our end of the bargain, and God always keeps his end of the bargain. And this is the contract to let you know what was written in the bargain, in Jesus' name. All right, so let's go to Psalms 1 and 3. Go to the book of Psalms. The book of Psalms. Where is everybody at this morning? Lord Jesus. Psalms 1. All right. I want to read, start at verse 1. Psalms 1 and 1. And we'll go down to verse number 3. Blessed is the one who does not walk in the step of the wicked condition, or stand in the way of the sinners. But, so here's the other end of it, whose delight is in the law of the Lord. Who does what? And who meditates on his law day and night. That person is like a tree planted by the streams of water, which yields its fruit in season, and whose leaf does not wither. Whatever they do prospers. Lord Jesus. Listen to this. We're going to try to work this scripture and keep it moving. I'm going to get done with this week so we can get back to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and all the rest of them in Jesus' name. All right. All right. Listen. He's letting you know the person who's blessed is the person who does not be in step with the wicked. The person who is blessed. The person who was blessed is the person who is not in stride, not in step with the wicked. That means how can two walk together except they agree? If you want to know who you are, listen, look at your friendships. You want to know who you are? Who do you hang around? Blessed is the one who is not in stride, not in step, not walking with, not walking in agreements with the wicked. You cannot be a vessel of light and hang around darkness. Now, you can. I take that back. But they cannot be, you cannot be in step with them. Because we're supposed to shine light in darkness. And I think that's a whole other subject we got to talk about. Because I know in the church, many times we're guilty. Good morning. Many times in the church, we're guilty of not wanting to fellowship with those who are outside the church. And I believe that we're supposed to let our light shine before men. So we can actually invite them into our homes. We can go to theirs. We can chill. But when we do it, we do it. We always keep, make sure that we keep in stride with the word. They can keep in stride with the world, but you keep in stride with the word. Keep in stride with the word and let you be the influence to them, not them be the influence to you. And if you're not strong enough to let just to set the temperature or the climate of the relationship, then you should leave that relationship alone. All right. But he says, blessed is the one who does not walk in step with the wicked. Do not walk in step with the wicked, which means you can. You can, but don't walk in step with them. Blessed are the ones. So that's one condition of the blessing. He says, nor stand in the way of sinners, or stand in the way that sinners take, or sit in the company of mockers. He says, listen, there's a way that sinners take. Don't have nothing to do with it. There is a way that sinners take. There's a path that they go. There's a thing that they do. We know what those things are. Don't do them. And that's so funny. When we start talking about stuff like this, the first thing we want to talk about, think about, is the club. And there's so many other tactics that the enemy has. You know, the pride of life. That's one of the tactics that the enemy has. You know, the pride of life. What is it? The lust of the flesh. That's another one. The lust of the eye. Those are the three weapons he has. Pride of life, lust of flesh, lust of the eye. That's what he has. He's going to throw those darts at you every single time. In those particular areas, and we can talk about that later. There's so many things we can do, but those are the three darts that the enemy has, and he uses them proficiently. If you look in the beginning and look at Genesis, you look at he did the pride of life, he did the lust of the flesh, lust of the eye. If you look in Matthew and Luke, when Jesus was tempted, he did the pride of life, the lust of the flesh, lust of the eye. With Jesus, you know, that's his weapons. With you, with me, that's what he's coming with: pride of life, lust of the flesh, lust of the eye. That's what he's going to do. Now, there's so many different things that fit into those categories, but that's what he's going to do. Don't do it. He says, don't even go that way. Don't even go that way. Almost like the same scripture said, don't give the devil a foothold. That's what this is saying here. Don't even do it. He says, these are the blessed people. These are the blessed people. We want the blessing of God. This is what we got to do. Right here. Then he says, listen here. But, so now he's giving the contrary. He's saying, okay, this is the blessed people. Blessed people don't do these things, but this is what they do. This is what they do. This is what the blessed people do. Now, I'm blessed. Somebody say I'm blessed. All right? This is what you do if you're blessed. But who's the light? This is what I enjoy. It's in the law. It's on his law. I'm sorry. But it's in the law of the Lord who meditates on the law day and night. That means every morning, every night, we need to be in the Word of God. Every morning, every night. It's not just Wednesdays and Sundays. It's every morning and every night. This is what the blessed mean. This is what blessed people do. This is your instruction manual. This stuff is not hard. I promise you it's not hard. You want to be, well, I didn't say want to be blessed. You want to, well, yeah. This is what blessed people do. Why? Because you're changing your heart. You're renewing your heart. You're renewing your heart. You're getting the 30 to 40 to 50 years of worldliness in you, of the stuff that the world taught you, and you're actually being reprogrammed with the kingdom of God inside of you. You're switching systems, and we have to understand that our spirit has never been programmed. This word is transforming our heart and transforming our spirit. Your flesh has been leading you all the time. We got to deny the flesh. Deny the flesh. Get in this word and begin to grow into the spirit of God and say, this, you want to just be distinguished between you and the world? This does it right here. This is what does it. So, and day and night, meditated on it day and night. And watch this. That person, somebody say, that's me. That person is like a tree planted by the rivers and stream of water. Now listen, the tree that's planted by the rivers and water ain't going nowhere. It's not going to be moved in Jesus' name. It's not going to be moved. It's not going to be moved. Now listen, you know, we talked about how there's some things we got to pluck up, pull up, and root up. Remember we talked about that? Some things we got to pluck up, root up, and pull up. Well, or burn up, brother. One was burn up. Well, this here right here saying that once you get planted by the river, your roots are going to spread out and you're going to clamp on so tight and so big that you're not going to go anywhere. He said, you'll be like a person that's planted by a tree by the rivers of water, which yields its fruit. Listen, you ain't going nowhere. You're going to be stable. You're going to be mobile. And you're going to be fruitful in the name of Jesus. When we say fruitful, I'm believing the fruit of the Spirit. But I'm also believing that there's going to be some fruit of prosperity in your life. That's when he said yields its fruit. I mean, the tree is reproducing. The tree is yielding and doing what it was supposed to do. Why? Because it's established in the Word of God. It's establishing the word of God. It's establishing the word of God. He says, you're going to yield your fruit. And I really want to keep going, but I got to hit it today. Whose leaf does not wither. So listen, ain't no dead stuff on you. That dead stuff is not on you. And that's the part. Whatever you do shall prosper. Somebody say, whatever. Now, we quote that scripture all the time. You know, God said, whatever I do shall prosper. But what was the beginning of the scripture? He says, this is what the blessed people do. They do not stand in the way of the sinner. They do not sit in the seat of the mocker. He says, but what they do is that they meditate on the word of God day and night. Matter of fact, your delight is in the law of the Lord. That's your delight. You enjoy this stuff. You get up and say, I can't wait to get and find a new word today. That's what blessed people do. I'm not making this up. This is not my formula. Matter of fact, I don't even think it's a formula. This is just what God said blessed people do. Now, the great thing and the good thing about it is you can always choose what you want to do. It's your choice. It's your choice. And this is how you know is when the word is authentic. When you can go to scripture after scripture after scripture and God's word is saying the same thing, that means that God is really serious about it. And the man of God is not manipulating the word of God to get you to see or do something that he's preaching. It's what the word of God is saying. Well, we read yesterday in Joshua chapter 8, he says, do these things, bind them up on your lips. And then what? Then you can place your foot whatever you want to and it will be given unto you. Then y'all know the scripture we always quote, wherever you put your foot, that's when the Baptist preachers be like, wherever you press your foot, God is going to give it to you. Y'all know that? Okay, well, that scripture right there, there are some other requirements to that. Just like some other requirements to this. And there's one thing, meditate on the word. Meditate on the word. What is meditate? Meditate is simply this, meditate. What are you feeding yourself? What are you consuming? Are you consuming this word or are you consuming that the world is putting into your system? One of two things, word or world, word or world, word or world. You have to begin to get into this word. Let the word transform your heart. The heart will then begin to speak out of the abundance of the heart. It will come up out of your mouth. And your mouth is the blueprint for your life. When you speak it, you'll start seeing things come to pass because you're not speaking your words. You're speaking his words. And his word cannot return void. It cannot. And then you'll look up and people be like, man, something's different about you. It is something different about me. You know why? Because as a man thinketh in his heart, so is he. And your heart has been renewed and been changed by the word of God. You don't have to will it. You know, willpower. Oh, God, help me stop cussing. Oh, God, help me stop cussing. Oh, God, help me stop being bitter. Oh, God, help me. And yes, we want to focus on that stuff. We want to concentrate on it. But we can't do it. Flesh cannot control or tame flesh. If that was the point, we wouldn't need the blood of Christ. If that was the point, we wouldn't need the word. The word does the work. You want to stop cussing, you want to stop sinning, you want to stop walking in sin, get in your word. The word will transform your heart. Your heart will then transform your actions and your minds and your words. It will happen automatically. Get in your word. Get closer to God. And you'll wake up and be like, man, Jesus, I ain't cussing. I don't know how long. Or it'll be that time where you get mad and you be like, you know what? I don't even feel like doing that. I refuse to let me lose my conviction. I refuse to. Not going to do it. All right. So he says, whatever, this is when you get here, he says, whatever you do shall prosper. Prosperity is not a surprise. It's not a surprise. I expect it. God, you said, whatever I do, that means if I choose to play marbles, I'm going to be prosperous in it. If I open a marble company, if I open a cracker company, or if I say I'm going to plant a garden in the back, I expect that garden to be fruitful. I expect it to bring 30, 60, 100 fold. Why? Because your word said it. I'm blessed no matter what I do, where I go, how I do it, because I put you first, because I'm in your word, because I've changed my mind, changed my heart. It's going to prosper. You need to expect prosperity. Man, listen, I remember this. This is the honest goodness truth. There's a little story. I was at Purdue as a freshman. I was sophomore. Sophomore at Purdue. First apartment ever in my life. I was so excited. So excited. And mama said, you can't have my mattresses. I said, oh, man. All right. It's cool. I get the bedroom set, but I don't get the mattresses. I can get some mattresses. You know, this is the real true story. So I'm like, yeah, I'll get some mattresses, man. Big deal. So only problem is I had never bought mattresses before. I didn't know how much mattresses cost. So I'm this naive dude who have no clue about what mattresses cost. But I've been in my word. That's all I did was be in my word. This is when I was sold out for God. Matter of fact, most of the stuff I teach today came from my sophomore year in college. Because that's all I did. I eat, slept, drink the word of God. Man, it was unbelievable. And so I remember my girlfriend came over and we was decorating the house, putting stuff around. And she says, well, my roommate, our thermostat went on the car. Can you help her change? I was like, yeah, ain't no big deal. I'll help change your thermostat. So I went down there and she didn't have any tools or anything. So we had to go to the store. On the way to the store, guess what we passed? A mattress store. So I said, on the way back, I need to stop there. And they said, okay. So it was like a Sealy's mattress or something. It was like just all they did was sell mattresses. So I went in. I started looking at them prices. And I was like, y'all ain't got no used mattresses. I didn't know. I really didn't know. I was like, y'all ain't got no used mattresses or nothing in there. And they was like, no. I'm like, oh. I'm a college student. I was looking for some mattresses and whatever. And the woman says this. She says, you know what? The owners are not here, but they got a personal mattress set in the back. It's pretty new. I don't know what they're going to let it go for. But I'll go, I'll make sure I contact them and let them know, whatever. I said, well, can I have your number? Said, yeah. So I get back to the apartment. My phone's not on yet, but the phone is working. This is a true story. I promise you. This is before I had a cell phone. This is like 95. So, yeah, we didn't have cell phones in 95. We had pagers. Y'all remember them? So, and I didn't even have one of those. So, the phone is working. Thank God the phone is working in the apartment. And I don't know if somebody didn't turn the phone off before or whatever, but it still works. And so I'm blowing their phone up. Every 15 minutes, I'm calling them, calling them, calling them, calling them, like for real. And it's late. It's late. It's probably like 7, 8 o'clock in the afternoon, and they about to close. And my girlfriend was like, hey, we got the house together, whatever, you know. You can come spend the night at my house. I was like, the devil's a lie? Mm-mm. Nope. I remember saying this like yesterday. God said that He was going to bless me. He said he's going to open up the windows of heaven. He said he's going to do this. I believe he's going to do it. I'm going to get this mattress set today. He got to keep his word. I promise you, I was this sold out. God got to keep his word. Nope. I've been tithing. I've been in my word. I've been doing what's right. I ain't been doing all this other knucklehead stuff that all my friends are doing. I've been sold out for God. God is going to keep his word. Now, mind you, all I have is $60. I am not making this up. All I have is $60. That's it. That's all I got to my name. And I have no clue how much these mattresses are going to cost. Matter of fact, I had no clue. This is how, man, listen. Anyway, so finish the story. So finally call and they're there. So I began to talk on the phone to the owner. And he said that he was looking to get, you know, a little bit more money than what I had. And I was like, well, sir, you know, I really need these mattresses. I'm a college student and yada, yada, yada. He's like, okay, well, I tell you what, I let him go for $50. I was like, okay. He says, but I can't deliver them. I don't have no way to come get them. This is the true story. I promise you. I don't have no way to come get them. How much would it cost for delivery? He's like, you know what? Where are you at on campus? And I was like, well, I'm in the Chauncey Hill apartment. She's like, okay, I'll tell you what. I'll just bring them to you. Okay, great. So now mind you, he wants $50. I got three 20s. So he gets there and he looks at me. He says, you go to Second Baptist? I said, yes, sir. You just preached your first sermon, didn't you? I said, yes, sir. I remember you. I was like, oh, okay. You go to Second Baptist? He's like, yeah. I've been going there for so many years and blah, yada. I was like, okay, well, you know, God bless you. Thank you so much. And so I went to pay him and I was like, I got 40 or 60. He said, man, just give me the $40. True story, man. I promise you. Now that I'm older and I've actually bought a set of mattresses and I know how much mattresses cost, I'm like, I remember when I got the mattresses for $40 delivered to the door. And when I said they were brand new, he said he had kept them for 6 months. He owned a mattress store. They decided to get another one. I think they were either too hard or too soft for his wife's back. And he had them 6 months. Brand new. Brand new. But I put my faith on the line. My heart was in the word of God. My mind was in the word of God. And he said, I expected God to do it. Even when my girlfriend was like, oh, no, you know, we can just do it tomorrow. No. God said... That's how we got to be in the word. Listen, you got to believe in your heart 100%. God said it. And I don't know why. I don't know why this happens. But God always waits till the last minute. He always waits till the last minute. Don't get nervous. God said in his word, God cannot lie. God will not fail. I believe he's going to do it. I'm expecting him to do it. I'm expecting to prosper. I'm expecting to be blessed. I'm expecting to be in good success. Why? Because he said it in his word. I'm expecting it. The power of expectation goes with your prosperity. It goes with it. I got to expect it. Why? Because I know what he said in his word. I know what he said in his word. Let's go to Psalms 119:48. Psalms, who is this? It's Psalms chapter 1. I don't know why I went all the way back in the back, like the New Testament. Psalms 119:48. You got to expect it, y'all. Psalms 119, verse 48. Y'all ready? Let's read. Reach out for your commands, which I love, that I may meditate on your decrees. Listen, this is another place where God's saying you got to meditate on the decrees. Meditate on the word of God. What are you feeding yourself? What are you feeding yourself? So I'll reach out for your commands, which I love. Do you love the commands of God? If you love them, you can speak some stuff out your mouth and you can begin to command what he command and watch those commands begin to manifest in your life. So when he said, whatever you bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, watch it work. Watch God work just by feeding your heart. Feeding your heart. Well, how do you feed your heart? Watch what you put in your eyes, and watch what you put in your ears. If it does not hit the filter was Philippians chapter 4. If it's not lovely, if it's not true, if it's not good report, if it's not of excellence, if it's not of the virtue, if it's not of virtue, if it's not of these things, we don't put it into our spirit. We don't do it. You are feeding yourself. Your light, the Bible talked about in Matthew chapter 6. Was it Matthew chapter 6? Yeah, 6:22. It says, your light is the lamp of your body. The light. Your eyes are the lamp of your body. You want to see somebody in darkness? Watch what they put in their eyes. Watch what they put in their eyes. Want to see somebody full of light? Watch what they put in their eyes. Well, the Bible talks about how the Word of God is light. Jesus is light. He's the light of the world. You want to be full of light? Boom, right here. This is your light. It's a dimmer switch, y'all. Everybody, you got a dimmer switch. You got the more word you get, the more you turn that dimmer up. The more word, less word you get, the more you turn that dimmer down. You got to get in this word. We do all kind of stuff. We want the microwave way into the word. No, there's no quick way. There's no other way about it. Listen, you are saved. I'm not saying you, when you listen, the Bible says you confess with your mouth, you believe in your heart, that your total being, you are saved. But there's so many other things that come with salvation. And some of them are the blessings of God. The blessings of God. It's almost like you got two kids. You got one child that's always into something. He always into something. And the other child always listens to you. He's always obedient. He's always in his books. He does everything the right. The other one's always into something. Now, the one that's always into something always wonders, well, why he get this? And why he get that? And you got a favorite. No, it's not a favorite. It's called obedience. And because he obeys, I reward. Because he's doing these things the correct way. Because he got good grades. Because he keeps his room clean. Because I can trust him with the vehicle. Because he listens to mommy and daddy. Because he does these things. What? I now can trust him with more and I can give him more. Now, it doesn't mean I love you any less or love him any more. It just means that because of the way he acts, I can trust him more. And he gets rewards for what he does. That's what the word of God is. God says, listen, I love all y'all. I love every last one of y'all, sinners and saints. I love all y'all. All of y'all my kids. But these are obedient kids. They act like me. They do like me. They do what I say. I can trust them. I can leave the house and not have to worry about them throwing no party or nothing. So I can trust them at home. I can give them the car. I don't have to worry about them going after food in my car. God says, look, I can give them this stuff and know that they won't leave the stuff for me. It's the same concept. Doesn't mean God loves somebody more or somebody less. It just means that you're obedient. He can trust you more. You got the same heart he has. Get in my word. Get in my word. That's what it says. All right. Let's go to Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13. And we're not going to even do it today. Read Matthew chapter 13. I want you to read 3 through 8. Matthew chapter 13, verse number 3 through 8. And when we resume tomorrow, we're going to be talking about your heart is where the word is sown. Your heart is where the word is sown. So we talked about what are you meditating on. We talked about what are you eating? What are you consuming? We talked about how the eyes and the ears are the way to the heart. Now we're going to talk about how the word of God is sown in your heart. That's where the word of God is sown. It's sown in your heart. It's sown here. That's where you're going to get your harvest. Well, not here. It's actually in your heart, your soul. And I think we might even do something about that on Friday. What's today, Thursday? Yeah, we might just do body, soul, and spirit tomorrow. Body, soul, and spirit tomorrow is probably what we're going to end up talking about. So we have a deeper concept of what the body, soul, and spirit is. And what are their functions? What do they do? What are they attached to? How do they work? Just a really in-depth study about it. And really think I'm going to do that. Really, really think I might do that. So I'll see you guys tomorrow morning. I will not be getting suspended this week. Thank you guys for being patient with me this week on helping me get some other business stuff together. Help me get some rest last night. I actually got some rest. Thank you, Jesus. Y'all don't know if y'all seen me yesterday. I was, Jesus. But today, I'm invigorated in Jesus' name. I thank you, Lord. All right, so we gone. I'm going to let you guys out in time today. Listen, we got this 7:30. That's what happens when you're restored, when you're revived, when you're invigorated. Is that you're punctual in Jesus' name. So, Matthew chapter 13 is what we're going to start at tomorrow. Well, on Monday, we'll start there. I really, really, I'm just going to take my time. We're going to get through this word. We're going to get back to the people who are our patriarchs and how they are blessed. Our patriarchs were blessed. They were paid. They were rich. They were wealthy and had no shame about it. I mean, they weren't hiding the fact they were blessed and rich. We ain't got to hide it. When God bless us, God says, I want them to know you blessed. Why? Because I want them to know who blessed you. It ain't about you. About him. I want them to know who blessed you. If I did it for you, I'll do the same thing for them. And so when we see people that's blessed, he said, if he did it for them, he'll do the same thing for us. He will. He got enough to go around. I promise you we do. Listen, I'm gone. I'll be back here tomorrow, 7 o'clock a.m. God bless you. I love you. I pray that you have a blessed and abundance day. We will start back on Monday doing our confessional every single day. If you do not have it, I will be sending those out today. I think I got two new emails about the confessional. So I'll be sending those out today. I pray God just plays rains, blessings up down upon you throughout this day. I love you, and I'll see you tomorrow morning. All right, bye-bye.